Good evening, everybody, and welcome to our Benedictine Conversation entitled Longing for Meaning, Seeking the Heart of God with Pastor Dave Mesner, who I'll introduce in just a moment. My name is Dawn Carrillo, and I'm the director of the Center for the Spirituality and Enrichment, which is a ministry of the Sisters of St. Scholastica here in Duluth, Minnesota. We have all of you muted tonight. If you have any comments during the program, we encourage you to send those in through the chat function, which should be at the bottom of your Zoom screen. You can do that at any time. And then if, I'll remind you again into the conversation because we love getting comments and questions from our viewing audience. So tonight I have the pleasure of welcoming Dave Mesner. Pastor Dave is an oblate of the Order of St. Benedict here at St. Scholastica Monastery. He's also a spiritual director. He received his Master of Divinity at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School in Deerfield, Illinois. And he has a Ph.D. in Biblical Studies and Classics from Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois. Dave has served in multiple congregations and faculty positions in his 40 years of ordained ministry. Most recently, he's been the lead pastor of Lutheran Church of the Good Shepherd here in Duluth, Minnesota for the past 20 years. And he resides here in Duluth with his wife, Joyce. And so, Dave, I am so excited for this conversation, for talking about your journey as you have longed for meaning and sought the heart of God. And so welcome, a deep welcome to you in this conversation. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Dawn. I'm excited to be here.
Yeah. So, we're going to have Dave agreed to do an opening prayer for us tonight, and he's going to do that in just a minute. But as we begin this conversation, Dave, I'm just wondering if you could tell us a little bit about yourself. What do you think our viewers need to know about you as we have this conversation together?
Well, there's lots they need to know, of course, Dawn, but what I'm thinking of in particular is that a life lesson that I'm learning is that we must go deep enough to meet the presence of God beneath the surface levels of our life. And I think that's our calling as authentic human beings, and I'm excited to be able to grow in that area and to do that. And I'd like to just share, in answering that one question, I'd like to use last Sunday's gospel text from the fifth Sunday of Lent. It was from John chapter 12, where Jesus said, "The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified, and that when I am lifted up from the earth, I will draw all people to myself." Amazing that this gospel that begins within the beginning in this cosmic context then gets down to all people. I will draw to myself when I'm lifted up from the earth. And one of the questions we often ask is, who are the all people here? who's counted in this? Is it all Lutherans or all Catholics or all, if you fill in the blank on that one? And of course, great diversity exists in our theological landscape and in our cosmic landscape. But I also believe with this, we need to go deep enough to the place where this Creator God meets all of humanity. Below the details of our surface into our heart level, where any person will love God with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love their neighbor. And the one thing that I want you to know about me tonight is that I'm committed to living on that level and to seeking that relationship. And I want to begin with a prayer. And one of the, my favorite prayers that has emerged for me is the morning prayer. And this is especially a series of prayers that were have been very meaningful to our congregation, especially during the pandemic and coming out of the pandemic, when we wondered about how things are going to be happening and how long they will happen. So this was a prayer for morning prayer. And I invite you to pray with me, and the Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Mighty God of mercy, we thank you for the resurrection dawn, bringing the glory of our risen Lord, who makes every day new. Especially we thank you for the sustaining goodness of your creation, for the new creation in Christ, and all gifts of healing and forgiveness. For the gifts of relationship with others, for the communion of faith in your church. Merciful God of might, renew this weary world, heal the hurts of all your children, and bring about your peace for all, the living Lord. Especially we pray for those who govern nations of the world, for the people in countries ravaged by strife or warfare, for all who work for being priests and international harmony, for all who strive to save the earth from carelessness and destruction, for the Church of Jesus Christ in every land. O God, you have called your servants to ventures of which we cannot see the ending, by paths as yet untrodden, through perils unknown. Give us faith to go out with good courage, not knowing where we go, but only that your hand is leading us and your love supporting us. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen. That is beautiful, quite beautiful.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. Sets us in a good context, a good mind context. So I love what you just said a minute ago about, and you were very emphatic when you said, I want you to know that I am committed to this. And I know through our conversations as we prepared for tonight, you and I, Dave, we talked about how that commitment has also led you to become a Benedictine oblate in this community here in Duluth. So I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about that journey and the impact it's had on you.
Thank you. I would love to share that. I want to thank Jane Dolter and Sister Lois and Sister Jane of the Oblate community for inviting me to write this up as an article in the current Pathways. Mm-hmm. So if anyone wants to find the second version of this, there it is. The story becomes when my wife Joyce and I came to Southwest Minnesota to begin our ministries. We were both called to Lutheran congregations in the large city of Clarkfield, Minnesota. and Joyce, as a clergywoman, discovered a spiritual support group at a place called the Center for Spiritual Development in Bird Island, Minnesota. Mm. And so she met with these clergywomen there on a regular basis. And this was a spiritual center run by the School Sisters of Notre Dame. And we were just so touched by how an important part that was for Joyce's life. That was at a time when every one of those women in that clergy support group, they were Lutheran pastors and other denominations as well, found themselves being the first woman in their ministry setting. And mm-hmm. all of the cultural dynamics they would meet in that case, and they found that need to be in great support with each other. And like I do, I like to follow my wife around a lot. She knows where she's going. And I learned to come to the Center for Spiritual Development at all. Also, and a few of us husbands of these clergy wives began meeting there regularly. And we learned, Dawn, about spiritual direction, which I had never heard of before that time. And it was just touching my heart. And by the way, in the meantime, I was not only pastoring this Bergen Lutheran Church, but I was finishing writing the last chapter of my dissertation, so deeply involved in biblical study. But the spiritual direction just touched a deeper place in my life. And learning that, I learned the dynamic of Lectio Divina. First time I had heard that, and learned to study and to learn to listen to God's word and have it enter into my heart, and that my study of the word would go deep enough to touch me on the heart level. And I actually became a spiritual director through that relationship then with the Center for Spiritual Development in Bird Island. And my project to become a spiritual director was to do a Lectio Divina exercise through Paul's letter to the Romans, which was the focus of my doctoral dissertation on Paul's use of Hebrew scripture in Romans. So all of these pieces, these were joining together. These spiritual rivers were starting to flow together. And my friends at Luther Seminary invited me to teach a class to Lutheran pastors and to lay leaders on the preaching responsibilities of the lectionary. And so I thought that would be exciting. I would love to know that myself. And so I began to learn about the source of the lectionary. And of course, all of those arrows started pointing back to Vatican II and the 20th century liturgical renewal. And those arrows then started going from Vatican II to a place called St. John's Abbey,
yes,
in Collegeville, Minnesota. And as I was learning the history and the theology of that tremendous accomplishment in liturgical renewal, that became part of my soul passion then. And then invited to do this teaching, and I did that for 18 years, for six cycles through the cycle of the lectionary. And so the scripture really became embedded in my heart in this process of doing this. And of course, then I started going to St. John's Abbey. It was only an hour and a half or 2 hours away from our home. And I would go there for spiritual direction and for conferences, and learned for the first time the word oblate, which I never heard before then. And as I learned what it was, I realized to become an oblate would be to name what was already true in my life.
Can you repeat that? To name what was already true?
All those passions that I had about Lectio Divina and spiritual direction and the lectionary and the liturgy, all those pieces coming together, found their same expression as an oblate. So going through that preparation program and through the oblation process was very exciting for me. I loved and still do the rule of Benedict. I love daily prayer and the lectionary, Lectio Divina. That's just part of my spiritual practices. So maybe that's my overall theme tonight, is that I'm trying to go deeper than the surface level to find the deepest level of meaning that I can experience. So that's what led me to become an oblate. And as one thing would lead to another, my wife Joyce and I had been going to the boundary waters forever for our vacations. And from living in parsonages, we thought it'd be a good idea to actually have a home to live in someday. And so we're looking for a place to do that. And we fell in love with the North Shore. We fell in love with Duluth. And then purchased our retirement home in Duluth on Park Point. And so we were still living down in Southwest Minnesota, but this became our home that we would ultimately live in. And we began coming up here for vacations and got connected to a place called the McCabe Renewal Center. Have you ever heard of that one?
Oh, yeah.
And we met Sister Lois over there and Terry and went to workshops there and began spiritual direction. And so that all happened from a distance where we're still down in Southwest Minnesota. And I'll take a drink here. And then 20 years ago, in 2004, the calling of the Holy Spirit, I was called to be the lead pastor at Lutheran Church of the Good Shepherd. And so that's been now just over 20 years this January. And since I already was connected at McCabe and at the monastery, I began attending oblate meetings there and became harder to travel down to St. John's Abbey on Sunday at 1 o'clock to meet with the oblates after my worship experience. And so in 2008, I transferred my oblation to St. Scholastica Monastery.
Okay.
And so that's been the beginning of my time in that community. And it's been an exciting time. It's carried me in all sorts of ways. The St. John's Bible, we've shared four different collaborations with the St. John's Bible, with our Lutheran congregations, with the sisters at the monastery, including the 500th anniversary of the Reformation, and where we had an experience of celebrating the joint declaration on justification by the Roman Catholic Church and the Lutheran World Federation, so that we have theological foundations for all of this deep synthesis that has happened. And so that started in 2008, and it's continuing.
I can almost, as you're talking and telling us about these different pieces on the journey, I'm resonating, especially with as you speak about how powerful your spiritual direction training was for you. For me, it started to put pieces together that I didn't even know there were any gaps. So that was a very interesting thing for me too. So I'm hearing, you know, your whole career has been moving into this deeper and deeper place as you have followed the promptings of the Spirit, you know, within your own heart. And I know you're about to go through a major shift in your life, which is that of retirement. So what's next on this powerful journey?
Well, I'm answering that question a lot these days. I'll be retiring at the end of April. Uh-huh. And I guess I've been kind of resisting it because I've always thought of retirement as people say, oh, then you can play golf and then you can go on cruises and things like that. And I don't think I'm finished doing what I'm called to do yet. So I've always kind of resisted that in a way. But I realize that what's calling me to retirement is the dream of more time in study of scripture and Lectio Divina and living that out on that particular level. I'm longing for the time to be able to pray through the Psalter and to see the power of each psalm in its original setting and how it's been gathered together in its current setting and how it speaks to us today.
Yeah.
I'm longing to continue to do that with the Gospels too. And a thing like COVID happened, but we've always been busy at Good Shepherd. but after the COVID, where we completely shut down, of course, and didn't have in-person worship for 14 months. Mm-hmm. And then now we're back, but we're still working really hard, I'll say.
Yeah.
And so I'm really looking forward to that oasis of spirit that'll happen, the opportunity to go deep.
Well, we look forward to it too, because as we're going to talk about a little later, it's going to intersect with your oblate context and so forth. I was intrigued when we met in our preparation meetings for tonight. I wonder, you talked about a couple of sabbatical experiences that you had had, and I was just amazed at the creativity of these sabbaticals. But you also spoke about your retirement as moving into a living Sabbath.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm wondering if you could say more about this. What exactly did you mean by that?
Yes, I mean Sabbath in the way that Abraham Heschel described it in his book, The Sabbath, where eternity breaks into our lives today, in meeting God in this place of rest, not just physical rest, but spiritual rest. And a great impetus for me on that dawn was the Lilly Foundation. I know they sell pharmaceuticals. I don't know what their social standing is in the world, but they have a very generous sabbatical grant.
Mm-hmm.
And some years ago, both my colleague, Pastor Tim Birdall, and I eventually applied for a Lilly grant for a sabbatical. And what Lilly is committed to in their granting process is they don't fund production. Like that would be like the academic model of a sabbatical where you go and you write a book or you do something to get the next degree. But they fund this. They ask this question: what makes your heart sing?
Wow.
What is it that, and that's exactly the question that Abraham Heschel asks. What is it that makes your heart sing? What gives you life? What do you have? What's the source of your spiritual life? And as I prayed and mused about that, the answer began to present itself. And so my application for the Lilly Foundation sabbatical grant was Romans, running, and opera. Of all those three things together are what make my heart sing. And so it was designed that I would go to Rome, and we did. I did Lectio Divina of Romans prayer every day. We were able, because of the grant, it's a once in a lifetime grant. It's a $45,000 grant that Lilly gives for sabbatical renewal. So went to Rome. We had a rooftop terrace apartment. And so every morning I would be praying Lectio Divina through Romans and the Psalter. That's the place where the Psalter really began to be alive for me as well.
Wow.
And then almost every day, Dawn, I would then, even though it's hot in Rome in the summer, at noon or whatever, I would go for a run. I was a marathon trainer in those days before my hip replacement. And I went to a place called Doria Pamphili, like an arboretum in the city of Rome. And every day I would go for a run there. And without fail, every time, the physical act of going through the running experience in nature deepened and consolidated and synthesized what I'd been doing on the rooftop terrace in the Lectio Divina of Romans. And I began to see that the physical activity of that, they couldn't be separated.
Yeah.
And then the whole opera part, how that fits in, is it sings God's word into your heart. And you take ancient texts like the Bible or opera and get to have them enter your heart through music and through prayer.
Mm-hmm.
And so that was my sabbatical in 2009. In the city of Rome and in Tuscany, we got to hear, I don't know if you're an opera buff or not, we got to hear the Puccini Festival in Tuscany. And under the summer sky, the Tuscan sky, we heard Nessun Dorma sung.
Wow.
And just a lifelong memory of that happening. And then I attended the Wagner's Ring Cycle in Seattle as we came back. So Romans, running, and opera, scripture, physical expression, and music, the three of those together have become my secret recipe for nurturing my spiritual life. And I can tell when I'm falling behind in that, getting unbalanced. And I long for that, to be able to have that kind of balance. So, yeah, that's. And then the second sabbatical I had was then after COVID, I had a second sabbatical here at Good Shepherd. We had to divide it up into two summers because of the time. But that was then hiking the Superior Hiking Trail, praying the Psalter, and again, opera again.
And
those
doing
three
opera.
things. But the very same formula of the scripture, the physical expression, and the musical expression, those come together in spirit, and that feeds my soul. So,
wow, it's an amazing, it's a fascinating combination that lends itself to Lexio so beautifully, you know, that artistic piece and the physical piece, you know, as we ruminate when we move our bodies. Yeah, that's an amazing thing.
Yeah.
You
In the running world, they call it flow. There's a science of flow in the running world, and it does just what you just said, where the movement of the blood and stuff through the body facilitates spirit as well. So
wow.
yeah.
Wow. I want to get into a little deeper. We titled tonight, Longing for Meaning, Seeking the Heart of God. So I'm just kind of wondering if you could tell us what this means to you. And you've also used that phrase of meeting God at the heart level. So I'm hoping you can open that up for us too.
Yeah. I'll tell you how it works for me. And this is the way I think it's happened for me, Dawn. It's been the experience of Lexio Divina. We've mentioned that several times tonight already. But I couldn't imagine this conversation without that, without that presumption and that premise. Here's how I take Lexio Divina and how it works for me with scripture and with my life. To start with the Lexio phase, the reading phase. It can mean simply to read, but I think it means more than that. And I'm gonna quote Michael Patella, you know, from St. John's Abbey, when he describes the hermeneutics of the St. John's Bible and Lexio Divina. He says that this Lexio phase, it uses all the resources of critical scholarship, and you go deeply into the word. And that's where it happens for me in my heart. I've been incredibly blessed to be able to study scripture. And so I like to go to that level and do that kind of, do word studies and listen to the text, to quote the rule of Benedict, to listen with the ear of my heart and go as deeply as possible into that text as I can. And what I found is that the level of that engagement in the text determines the level to which it reaches my heart as well. And the level to which it gets lived out in my life. And I've learned that I don't think there's an end to it. I think it continues to go as deep as the heart of God is. So that's how I understand, that's the Lexio phase. And then the next phase would be meditation, or the meditatio phase. The Greek word for that would be to understand, you know, to bring together. And I understand that then as taking the fruit of my study of the word and then holding that up as a mirror. And I see myself in those words that I've been studying and praying through that process. And so and the word is so powerful through the Holy Spirit to penetrate into our heart level, and it becomes a place of synthesizing the study. And then the deeper rumination on that study. And then the third level of Lexio Divina is oratio, or the prayer. And the powerful lesson for me on that was that the secret of it is praying scripture. not the idea that we would come away with normally of a petition, you know, have a go to God with a grocery list of prayers, and sometimes we do, but the power for me of the prayer is this praying scripture, a conversation with God, of listening and speaking and confessing and praising and everything, thanking, all of that that emerges out of the biblical text, determines the power and the depth of the spiritual life. So I'm very committed to that process, and I couldn't imagine living without it. And then I understand the last one, the contemplation, is then that's like the glasses, where it becomes my lens through which I see the world as I'm living my life, or
sure,
watching the news, or I'm engaged in mission and ministry. That's how all of this begins to feed back together at a deep level. Hey, by the way, how many times have we used the word deep today? It's pretty common in our conversation, isn't it? I'll try to find a synonym for that.
That's okay. As you're talking about this, Dave, I'm thinking about how this heart work that you've been engaged in all these years, it's been tough academic work, but it's been heart work as you've, you know, brought your academics and your spirituality together with all of this. I would imagine, well, a couple of things I'm thinking is that it's had a profound impact on you in terms of how you've ministered in your congregation. And a big, huge part of that would be your preaching, you know? And I mean, what you're describing to me is what I do when I work with preachers and teach them preaching. Yeah. And so that's what you're talking about here, and giving in that contemplatio when you just mentioned that's the lens through which I see my life. And that lens is kind of paradoxical right now in our world, right? Our lives within this world, I think we're confronted by paradox. We're living in a chaotic and fast-paced world. We're distracted, very often superficial when you think of texting and social media and so forth. While at the same time, we're longing desperately for something more, for this deeper meaning. Everyone's longing, just like you have. So I'm curious your thoughts on this, and you know, do you have a sense of the impact it's had on your congregation and those to whom you minister?
Yeah, I'm not sure how to answer that. I know the impact it's had on me for being in a place of deep spirit that Lutheran Church of the Good Shepherd is. That's been a wonderful deep experience with the people of God in that place. And given we all know about the cultural changes that have happened in the last generation. Yeah. And I tell you, I think we have no choice but to have to go deep in the proclamation level in order to communicate and give meaning to the culture that's longing for meaning and purpose, all while at the same time, as you've described, moving so fast.
Yeah.
Not slowing down, take the time to seek that meaning in the place where it can develop. In fact, we've spent a lot of energy studying best practices on ministry in our culture today. And so the cultural dynamic, the current culture in which we live in, Charles Taylor, the Canadian philosopher, talks about the secular age that we live in, where it's defined by a denial of transcendence, the autonomy of the self, and acceleration. Just going so fast through technology, and we're all breathing that air. And so I believe what we are called in, the only thing we can no longer act like the church did a generation ago, where you simply announce a meeting and people show up for whatever reason.
Right.
But we have, when they come in our door, we better deliver in the area of transcendence. We better have an experience to meet God in the opening of the word and the sacraments and the gathering at the font. There better be an experience of being called into the kingdom of God and making a difference, you know, in the world today beyond just the surface level.
Right. Now,
Good Shepherd does that in beautiful ways, in lots of ways. But we are, like every other congregation, we're breathing the same air of this being culture and being called to go deep and to nourish our spirit. So I think there aren't short answers for that one.
Right.
I think there's no quick answer to it, but I think we have to really deliver some spiritual content. Yeah.
Well, and what you're saying about being called in this situation of chaos, fast-paced life, you know, pandemic, wars, et cetera, the distractedness and the superficiality, which is becoming more and more a part of our world, that you speak so eloquently, that this is the only thing we can do. Is what we're doing tonight, going deeper and talking about going deeper, that's the only antidote, or that's the only answer, because of that longing of the human heart. Yeah.
Yes.
You know, Go ahead.
Go ahead. That's fine.
Well, I was thinking of what you said in one of our conversations as we prepared for tonight, when you said, in every age, the call of the church is the heart.
Yeah.
That's what you're talking about here, isn't it?
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. That's the call of the church in every age. Think of the New Testament period. You know, it wasn't until 311 of the Common Era that Constantine, on his deathbed, made Christianity legal in the Roman Empire.
Right.
Otherwise, they were meeting in house churches and those places that I saw in the city of Rome when I was there on my sabbatical.
Yeah.
There was no civic support of the church.
Right. People were being martyred.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So I think that's the call in every age, to the heart level. We've been in a situation in this Western culture for, you know, a couple of centuries now, where the church has been a very important place for people. And in the last generation, that's really slipping. I mean, we know that's happening. All the surveys are showing that. But even if they weren't, we would be called to discipleship. We'd be called to spiritual life and growth. We'd be called to making a difference in the world. That when we're called to a person's bedside as they're dying, that we would have something to say, and we could say something to the family that is gathered there. I think that's the call of the church in every age.
Mm-hmm.
And I pray that we don't get too busy to live that out.
Right.
And to forget where we've, our heart, where we've come from.
Where we've come from and what that call is. Yeah, that's beautiful. I want to remind our viewers that you are invited to send in comments or questions for Pastor Dave. Please just send them in through the chat, and I will monitor the chat as these come in. While we're waiting for some comments, Dave, I just want to ask, When did your love affair with the Word of God begin? And I'm curious, one thing I haven't asked you before is why Romans? So when did your love affair begin? How did it begin? And why Romans for your dissertation, your sabbatical, your first sabbatical, et cetera?
Okay, good. Well, I'll try to make sure I answer that, Pierre. My love affair with the Word starts with learning to read. Now, that may sound trite, but I lived in a little community called Edgerton, Minnesota, where I grew up, and there was no kindergarten there, and I'm still trying to make up for that, the loss of never having gone to kindergarten. So I remember going to the first grade and being so excited to learn to read. And I remember going home, lying on my bed, getting lost in reading, and being carried to different. I was hungry for it. I couldn't not do it. Now, maybe I'm looking back. I'm just discovering that now. I also wanted to go outside and play baseball and basketball. I was doing both the physical and the spiritual from the very beginning, I guess. That goes very deep. So,
wow.
And then, in a time in college when I was searching, not knowing what I'm going to be when I grow up, I became involved in a campus ministry. And even though I packed my Bible superstitiously every time I went away just to school, I would pack it, put it on my shelf, and put it back in my suitcase when I left without having opened it in between. I started going to a Bible study, at college, and it really, wow, this could be alive and could be meaningful. That meant a lot. And so I went into, when I graduated, longing for meaning, I went into campus ministry for seven years. And a hunger was burning in me to really know the Bible at that point. Mm. And the last year of that was spent in Poland, while it was still a communist country. It was the year before the Solidarity Labor Union was formed that caused the overflow of the communist government, overthrow in Poland. And I was invited to teach in a Catholic setting with Father Blachnicki, who had been jailed in World War II in a German concentration camp. Mm. And invited my campus group to come and teach a discipleship and Bible to priests and to students. Mm. So that was my last year of campus ministry. And I came back and enrolled in seminary.
Wow.
And my first day in seminary is summer Greek, intensive Greek. And the professor said, there are people sitting other places of the world. And he used terrible language for this. He said, who would cut off their right arm to sit where you are sitting, to be able to learn the Bible in the original language.
Wow.
You know what I said?
What?
I said, yeah, you're right. You're absolutely right. And so I poured myself into that and was able to learn, Hebrew and Greek. And this was, had this hunger this life hunger was being fed on a spiritual level. And then, so I did an MA, I did the MDiv, and then the MA in New Testament and Matthew and Mark. I went to Northwestern for the Ph.D. And why did I pick Romans? I wanted to do something that connected the New Testament and the Old Testament. And my advisor there was in the process of writing a commentary, the Hermeneia commentary on Romans. And so he invited me and said, I'd like to invite you to write your dissertation on Paul's use of Hebrew scripture in Romans. And so I did. That became my title. And besides how important Romans has been in the history of the church, with every reformation that's happened and every renewal, just all of that. So I did how Paul used the Hebrew Bible in telling the gospel story in a letter to the Romans.
Veronica wrote in, and she's wondering if you have a favorite Bible translation. Is there?
I do.
Is there? Which one?
The NRSV.
Oh, great. That's my favorite one, too. Yeah.
Oh, good job. Well, there's two of us, but actually it's more than two of us, and it's because of, the St. John's Bible is in NRSV.
Yes, it is.
It's the most common English, translation, so that's my favorite.
Yeah. And then Karen is wondering if you have a favorite commentary on Romans.
I'm laughing because I do. And I'm going to show it to you.
Okay. I bet it's extremely thick.
We've just repacked my library here.
Yeah.
Oh, I brought it to church. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay.
It is. Here's what it is. It's the Hermeneia commentary on Romans, written by Robert Jewett, and that's my advisor, and so that's where some of my work shows up in that commentary. So that's why. That's my favorite.
That's why it's your favorite.
Because it's my guy who wrote it and my stuff is there.
Sure.
Part of my life was there too. So, yeah.
Wonderful. Tom writes in, beautiful testimony, Dave. I'm wondering if and how you've been able to draw your congregation into this deeper engagement with Scripture.
Yeah. Well, hopefully it happens. And the proclamation of the word through sermons, that happened week after week. One of the things we're going to talk about here is the Psalter and how excited I am about the God's word in the Psalter. But we've also done that at Good Shepherd, where we've had summer in the Psalms on two different occasions.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Where we have a daily lectionary that takes us through, the 3-year revised common lectionary. But then we create a lectionary for the summertime, for going through the Psalms together. Mm. And we've got a watercolor artist named Rosemary, who's now moved to New Jersey to be by her friends, of her family. She, during the 12 weeks of summer in the Psalms, she's a watercolor artist, among other things. She did a watercolor rendition of each of the 12 Psalms that we studied that summer.
Oh, beautiful.
And then we make them into postcards and other things like that. So
wow.
We tried to integrate that into our ministry and
that's
in those
beautiful.
Ways.
Tell me about... you mentioned in your sabbatical that's when you first started getting hooked on the Psalms. And so, I wonder, we first want to, we have a comment here from Sister Lois. So I'm going to pause for a second.
Sure.
Thank you, Dave, for your beautiful reflection on how your longing for meaning has led you deep into the heart of God. Your words tonight reveal that God's heart is the place where you live. Thank you, Sister Lois.
Thank you, Sister Lois. Yes.
So tell us about your shift to the Psalms.
Yeah.
Tell me what they mean to you. I know that you've spoken in our private times together of your wish to really do a deep, deep dive to the Psalms and spending time with the Psalms with other people, maybe in some retreat kind of format and so forth. So talk a little bit about that.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I think it would start with, it's impossible to be a pastor without the Psalms, of course.
Right.
I mean, what do you do when you go to the hospital and you have the 23rd Psalm and that touches every life situation? And so, yes, that's part of the pastoral ministry on the one hand. The second thing I'd have to say, Dawn, is that the reason I put it back at the first sabbatical is that Joyce and I began that sabbatical experience with a 1-week stay at the Abbey guest house at St. John's. And of course, went to the bookstore. And of course, by the greatest Christian bookstore ever, all that has.
A very dangerous bookstore it is.
It's very dangerous. And there I picked up this little volume that's only, 3 inches thick or so. It's that breviary, if that's how I pronounce that. The Benedictine Daily Prayer. So as I launched my sabbatical, it seemed kind of daunting to use this, but I did. So I started using this Benedictine Daily Prayer on my sabbatical. And I think what happened was critical mass. I started being exposed to more and more psalms than I ever had before in a regular rhythm. And so they became more of the input, into my life. So that's just a natural thing, that happened. The second time we did Summer in the Psalms, I began to do more reading on the scholarship of the Psalter.
Okay.
And in the last 20, 30 years now, there's been a strong emphasis on the final shape of the Psalter is intentionally, these 150 psalms are placed intentionally where they fit in the five books within the Psalter. But more than that, they answer the question, how did any one piece of scripture pass the immense barrier from a first telling to a second? How was it ever used and passed on and kept and used over and over and over again? And the answer that the scholars give for that, it tells us who we are and how to live. And that's what the Psalms do. And then so they ask the question, what would cause the Psalms to be gathered together? I mean, they come from different time periods, in history, over 1,000 years, that the individual psalms were written, and they reflect different stories. What would cause them to be pulled together into one book? And the answer that's given for that now, it would have to be a crisis event that would cause that to happen. And they look back to the history of the canonization. And the crisis event is the exile of the 6th century before the Common Era, when the Babylonians came to Israel, to Judah, and destroyed the temple, killed the king, took the people away in captivity to Babylon, and raised the question for the Jewish people, who are we? Without a temple for worship, without a priest, without a king, without a land, who are we? And they began to answer that question by this Torah, God's word. God's word is powerful and portable. I can be in a prison in Babylon and open the Torah scroll, and God is present in that time. And so that huge cataclysmic event that changed a local religion into a world religion forever. And then, of course, the New Testament follows on the same pattern.
Wow.
So that one of the reasons I love it so much, Dawn, is it because I know about exile, too. In our own lives, we have times when we look at what's our life calling? What's our meaning in life? All of that, and what gives us answers to that? That's more than just the surface level of existence.
So I'm hearing you say that the Psalms are. It sounds to me like what you're saying is that the Psalms are entirely relevant in any age.
Exactly.
Huh.
They are meant to be, that's what the canon tells us, that they will give life to us in this setting. Part of the work is our work to listen to them, and they don't magically do it, without reading and hearing them. But,
right. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Veronica writes in, so interesting to hear about how the Psalms came together over time with that question, who are we? You know, that's yeah. We have another comment from Dennis and Susan that I want to make sure that we get in here, and we're getting short on time. What is your image of God, and how has it changed on your spiritual journey? That's a big question.
Yeah. Oh, I want to honor that question too. I can't imagine God, my experience of God, without the word, because that's how that's been mediated to me. So I have this sense of that that's very important for hearing God's voice and responding to God and imaging God. But one of the results of the Sabbath and the sabbatical and the spiritual and physical synthesis is that as I'm experiencing the beauty and the power of nature on a hike on the Superior Hiking Trail and sensing that word, you know, entering and ruminating on that and thinking about that, and it continues to deepen, then I see and I realize that in the cycles of nature around me, that I'm walking through this beautiful landscape, it's a living, dynamic relationship that's happening. Even at that moment, I'm experiencing God's presence through the word in my heart and physically experiencing it in the around the hiking, and then in all the ways that spiritual presence of God becomes incarnate in our lives. Babette's Feast, the movie, and the short story. This group of people sat around a table, and Psalm 85 happened. You know, the kingdom of God happened to these Danish pietists, wherever they were, as forgiveness and steadfast love and faithfulness and righteousness started happening in their relationships at that table. So how do I envision God? I don't know about a face, but I know about a presence. And then one of the things I guess I would say too about that, Dawn, would be that it used to be that we would start talking in spiritual language and people would at least know it culturally. That's no longer the case.
Well, I know.
We have people that are coming to our churches that have no spiritual background whatsoever.
Right.
And so how do we start the conversation?
And it's not that they aren't spiritual people. They
not
don't.
At all. No.
It's the language that you're talking about. Yes.
But they didn't grow up with their parents bringing them to Sunday school with a nickel in their hand to give in the offering, and all of that. They don't have that background.
Right.
So how do we know? I think we know through the power of the Holy Spirit and the fruit of that happening. Yeah.
I have to ask you one last question.
Okay.
Before we close. What is your wild hope for our world?
My wild hope would be the kingdom of God happening in our relationships with each other, with the creation, with the environment. My wild hope is how I describe with Babette's Feast, that happening in our relationships around a table, in a community, a family setting, tasting and seeing the presence of God. I think the world is crying out for it, and they're looking in the wrong place, or they're not looking, not taking enough time, you know, to look for it.
So it's time for us to close. The hour's gone by too quickly. We could plumb the depths of the Psalms and all sorts of things. But I want to ask you, Dave, Sister Jane just wrote, tasting and seeing the presence of God. I love it. And Veronica says a huge thank you to Dave. And yes, thank you so much, Dave. And I want to hand this back to you and to say, what would you like to leave us with tonight? Words, thoughts, what would you like to leave us with?
Yeah. I would say I'd like to leave you with going deep to the heart of God. Taste and see. And feel and experience that on the, even on the cellular level in your body. So that would be an invitation and a dream for each of us to experience that.
Beautiful. Yeah. Dave, thank you so much. This has been such a rich conversation. I want to thank you deeply. And I know everyone out there, our viewers, are thinking the same thing. We look forward with great anticipation to the next steps in your journey. And I hope to see a lot of you around the monastery. Yes.
Great. Yeah.
On behalf of the Sisters of Saint Scholastica and the Center for Spirituality and Enrichment, to you and your community at Good Shepherd, Dave, your family, to everyone who's joined us tonight, we wish you and your loved ones a beautiful Holy Week and Easter celebration filled with peace and love and resurrection hope. Amen. Thanks again, Dave.
Thank you, Dawn.
Good night, everybody.